Basically, I come to the shows to be with all these great people, to enjoy the music. The music's beautiful, the people are beautiful, and I mean, it's a great scene. You gotta come see it, you gotta see it for yourself. It's really hard to explain, it's just great, you know? I grew up in Boston. My mom's a school teacher. She's a really smart person. She's got her master's degree in earth science. My dad is a quality engineer for a big company in Boston that makes wallboard. At first, they were a little hesitant about, you know, they thought I'd grow out of it, but basically I haven't. And now that I'm taking my baby on tour with me and stuff, I mean, they're not real crazy about the idea, but they also realize that I'm doing what I want and I believe in it a lot. We survive in this parking lot. There's never any fights in here. There might be some real harsh words exchanged once in a while, but nobody ever comes to blows here. And I mean, if everybody could just get down and talk to each other, I think the world would be a better place.
Every now and then again, I got this feeling that I'm falling down from higher places that I found while across the sky.
The color and the pageantry of this event are just right out of the pages of rock music history. This isn't the Grateful Dead, but a group of deadheads entertaining a crowd that also very proudly claims that title. The Grateful Dead are one of not only of music histories, but a subculture and a phenomenon that has lasted almost three decades. Now we'll be taking a look at that phenomenon and the music that created it on King 5 News at 6:30. Well, you kind of wonder how many of them are wannabes and how many of them are true blues, but I think a lot of them really are dedicated to their lifestyle.
I'm a veterinary student at Colorado State University, and I follow the Grateful Dead in my free time, and last night I saw my 122nd show.
I've been on tour since I was about 14, on and off, because my family was pretty much split up by the time I was about 13 years old. So I was attracted to this group of people mostly because of the family, you know, environment that it provides for me.
It's kind of a weird, I don't know if I would call it a hippie dream, but my dream to gather all my friends and take them to fun places and just celebrate life together. I really try to like turn places I hang out, like these places, into my church. It's a church in the aspect where, like, you know, all these folks out here and stuff, we all have a kind of a common, not so much goal, but just a kind of a destiny following, where we want to keep each other happy and find all the good things in life that there are.
Because I love my friends here, you know. I got more friends here than I do in my hometown. I can go home to my hometown and walk around on the streets for 10 years and not meet as many nice people as I do in one day out here. This is a big movement. This is a revolution. And if you're just coming to the show to make money or sell grilled cheeses, you know, or something like that, or to score sheets to take home and get banked.
There's nothing wrong with selling grilled cheeses.
No, of course, there's nothing wrong with selling grilled cheeses. I didn't mean that.
My name is Toni Brown. I'm the publisher of Relics Magazine. I've been publishing Relics for the past 15 or so years. I went to see the Grateful Dead for the first time in 1969. I was relatively young. I was, I think, 13 years old, and I was with some older college friends. And it was definitely a pivotal point in my life. I changed 1,000%. I just went from being a 13-year-old naive little girl to just wanting to know everything that was happening in the world around me from that one experience. I really don't know that music changes everyone's life that immediately, but it did for me. This issue was our cover on mandatory minimums and how it affects the deadhead scene. This was absolutely our most important issue. My favorite cover is our psychedelic year-end issue from last year.
This here is it's called a didgeridoo, a diki. A diki is the real name for it in Aborigine culture. And they believe nothing in your life happens until you sing about it. And they call it dream time. And their dream time is like every day, the here now. And this sound is like the sound of the Mother Earth. It's a live planet breathing. I like to go to the jungle, so I call out animals I'm familiar with out here in the forest, and birds, and anywhere from like kangaroos to snakes and eagles and cockatoos, kookaburras.
I really hope that I graduate from vet school and the Grateful Dead thing is still going on. people bring their homes to the parking lot and they let the dogs out of their house, and their front yard is a parking lot full of people and cars and stuff like that. I've seen dogs hit by cars in parking lots. I've seen lost dogs. I've seen dehydrated and overheated animals, and I don't think it's fair the way people treat their animals, and I'd love to help out in some way as a veterinarian on tour.
And this instrument you've heard playing is made by termites, by nature. It's carved out by nature. You can see here, it's not man-made, it's made by termites.
We're going to see Jerry's Art Show downtown. Taking the monorail. Wow. Have you ever had 3D that image he thinks of when he's playing his guitar?
Have you ever had that feeling where you're getting sucked backwards and like spinning backwards like this, and it's like,
yeah.
It's like, yeah, it is. Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
Jerry Garcia's art, it's wonderfully fun. Everybody loves it. It makes everyone smile. It's such an opening experience for us. It's a new artist, and for the gallery anyway. And it's unlike anything we've ever done before. I think artwork in general, especially Jerry's work, is always a reflection of what's happening in the world. And this is it's a real show. It's real art and real people, and it's been a lot of fun.
That second night in Rock, man, that reminded me of why I go to guys' shows all the time to begin with.
Oh, man, and last night was great.
Wonderful. I heard they had like a new sound, man, and everything's so crisp, dude. Man, Phil's right out there, dude, and Vince, the harmonies are so great. That's like the first time, second night Expo, I felt like that was the first time that I really felt it all come together. You know, like Vince was there, and I knew he had it going on, but it like just, he's there. And
the crowd was there that night, though. I'm not like a real corny person, yeah. But that's the first time I've aimed it to
tears. All the shows are so, I mean, full of love, and it's just wild. I mean, everything. I never thought I would be touring with the Dead, and then all of a sudden you just get hooked. It's like a drug, and you get hooked on the Dead. It's cool. I'm totally tripping right now. It's kind of hard.
I started touring back in 1986, and I started making those flip books, and I traveled around with my child, but I stopped touring in 1990 because it seemed like the shows were more and more of a dangerous place to have children. It used to be more of a family atmosphere, so we like to come out here from Hawaii just like for a break of the mellowness of Hawaii. We need a little chaos in our lives.
JD has just turned 12 years old.
The best thing about going on tour is just like being there.
And I feel good about him being out in this world. If I had sheltered him in a neighborhood suburban type home and then he runs away from home all rebellious or something, I would be scared to death that something bad would happen to him. But as it is now, my son is streetwise. He ain't dumb. You're not gonna snowblind him. He'll probably get the money right out of your pocket. I mean, just go ahead and try to run a con game on him. He's good.
We've been on the tour for, about 3 years now. We conceived Rain at our first Dead show. We just met and just fell in love immediately, and everything worked out. And we had her 2.5 years ago in Atlanta at the Dead show. And it was a really beautiful experience, and we all traveled together, and it's just one big happy Dead kind of thing.
Well, if the Dead stopped going on tour, I would probably go mourning for a little while, but basically, what could I do? I'd have to go become a 9-to-5 person like everybody else. I'd have to go to work. I have a small son who's 10 months. I would love him to be able, you know, maybe when he gets his license, or maybe one of his friends gets his license, to be able maybe even see him. I don't care if they're in wheelchairs playing banjos. It would be great.
Yeah.
looked around, but to my surprise, there ain't nothing on my table. How can this be? I look in my bag and I'm out of weed. I'm gonna find someone who's got what I need. 'Cause all I've got left is stems and seeds.
Hello, my name is Turtle. I'm from California. I like to smoke pot a lot.
We're cleaning our house right now.
Got my dough.
A lot of people call us homeless, but I consider myself, you know, architecture.
This is my home. Yeah.
Family is.
I love them.
It's the only thing that keeps people together. It's the only thing that keeps us alive.
We follow the band with a bunch of people because it's all one thing. Like, it's inspiring for it to be one thing, you know, like, that's why I love them so much. And it's different from like hanging out in like Babylon, where you don't really care that much about your neighbor. Like here, everybody cares about each other, and the music cares about you, you know, and we all sing praises to each other.
That's a good way to put it, brother.
My parents think I'm crazy, yeah. Because in my philosophy on life, they think I'm nuts. They think I'm up in the stars.
Oh, I'll be on the road till
the death road takes strikes. Me off.
All I got left is stems and seeds.
I'm a paramedic, and when I work during the shows, I usually run a crew, and we'll go out into the crowd and help the people out, whatever, and get them into the Rock Med area so we can take care of them.
There's always medical problems. You're talking about a small city out here. Probably had 45,000 people inside and maybe 20,000 people out here.
Any kind of medical situation that can come up usually does come up. You know, anything. Colds, bee stings, allergic reactions, sometimes we go to car accidents.
We did have one tripper who climbed up on top of the press box up there and decided they wanted to fly to heaven. That was in the middle of the night a couple nights ago. Luckily, the police backed off, and in an hour or two we were able to talk him down, get him into the tent, and a couple hours after that, they basically were recovered and we were able to let them go.
First time I went to the show, it was kind of, you know, I got in and the music started and it was everybody was dancing, you know, and it was like, they all looked like they were, you know, nobody was dancing with each other. They were just all kind of dancing. Everybody's up and down and it's going like this, and I was just kind of, look at all these freaks, what the hell's going on? I was just kind of laughing at them, you know, and all of a sudden I looked down and I'm going like this, and then all these heads are going this way and that way, and pretty soon it's like, and then everybody's, and all of a sudden you got everybody's dancing together, and everybody's like one, and then the crowd gets excited, then the band starts getting excited, and then the crowd gets more excited, and everyone just starts feeding on everything, and then it's just this magical thing just happens, and it's just so beautiful, and that's the best way I could explain it. I don't know.
Magic happens while the band plays.
This is since Halloween night on the East Coast in Brendan Byrne Arena in New Jersey, right across from Giant Stadium, a business card in there too. A lot of Jerry Garcia band, a bunch of good Kvetches, East and West.
When you listen to music, it comes in, right? But when you listen to dead music, it comes out.
Really not on the road all the time, but 25 years, 30 years. I've either been riding motorcycles or riding in buses or cars. But the kids that are out here today are educated. Their family as a dead community is something they learn through sharing. There's a community that just, the world needs to pick up this community. to a degree where you see somebody struggling, you help them. My dad worked every day of his life, and I went to work at 16. And my impression of people at work is if you aren't enjoying your work and it's work, you're in the wrong business.
They think that they're happy because they don't know what happiness
material
is.
Happiness.
They've been brought up, materialistic.
My
they've been brought up in the society.
9-to-5 job. That sucks.
I mean, if you're living in Babylon and you're having to deal with all that shit, most people I know aren't truly happy.
But I think it's society. I think of my mom. And I try so hard to get away from society. Therefore, I don't talk to my mom very much at all.
People don't understand how easy it is to live without the 9-to-5 and stuff. We're getting ready to have a baby in a few months, and we're going to do that kind of on the road. And, you know, just do the best we can, and everything takes care of itself. You know, good things happen to good people.
That's another thing I think about the dead. It's Jerry I've seen walking through the parking lot when Bill Graham was still alive. And discussing the scene, and I've heard Jerry out of his mouth say, "This is my family. They bring us joy, we bring them joy."
I'm John Scott, and I write what some people call the Deadhead's Bible.
I was raised very much in the preppy mold. I went to private school in New York and then to Exeter and finally to Dartmouth. I asked them how they ranked various influences on their life, and the number one response was love. After that was friends, Grateful Dead logged a surprising third. Then health and family, and food, education, sex pretty far down the line, money even further down, work, spirituality, community, and bring up the rear are drugs and charity. 97.8% of those polled all own cassette decks. On the other hand, only 7.4% own a fax machine. 95% own a tie-dye t-shirt. Fast food, they like Taco Bell's and McDonald's, and then Wendy's as well.
My favorite breakfast cereal is Fruit Loops.
My favorite drink, lemonade. My favorite food is Cheetos.
Their favorite color is overwhelmingly blue, purple coming in about half that rate.
Purple.
And there's nobody like me in Harvest, Alabama.
25% of them own a Garcia tie. I think that's probably pretty telling right there.
I'm Thomas. I'm a bus mechanic on tour. I really dig tour. My first bus was a 47 Dodge that I found in a junkyard in Eugene, way far out. This is Eugene here. And I'm really fascinated by tour. I'm so into it. I learn as I go. I've learned so much just from building my first bus. I sold it at Dead Lot and bought my second bus, which is a wooden cabin 46 Dodge. And I'm so into it, I want to do any work on any bus that anybody comes up to me with, you know. Living in buses is my life. I live in a bus. I've lived in a bus for 5 years. I live in the hills. Really interesting culture in just bus gypsies. It's a true faction of American legends, man. True American folklore, bus gypsies. Check it out. Live in the woods, live simply. Back to the land styling pretty much is an overall feeling in general with the bus culture. And you can take your house on the road with you to wherever you want to go. This 58 Chevy Apache up here was available in the woods sitting down there in Humboldt, so we took it, lifted it up into the trees with come-alongs and trucker straps, drove this bus underneath. Oscar, good boy. Good boy, Oscar. Get inside. And love that dog, man. And so I just got finished doing another bus, a 46 Chevrolet with a Wayne coach on it. I put a 64 Volkswagen split window van on top, and that's the bus way. It's never finished either. It's always evolving. The only thing constant is change with everything, you know.
My name's Zane Kesey. My dad is Ken Kesey, and the Grateful Dead, they've been around for a long time, but they used to be a little garage man that used to be basically our garage. And I always thought that it was one song they were playing and they're making it up as they went along. It was always different. I had no idea that they actually played songs. Fun is where it's at. I grew up on Bubbles and Dayglow and Paint Your Face, and everybody was clowns, like having Wavy Gravy around all the time. I didn't know he was different. I thought everybody was part-time clown. I love this scene. I wish that this was here every week. You just find me. It's a full community. When I saw the Bottle and Can Redemption place, at that point you're a community. It's like Dad says, the 60s isn't over yet. Not until the fat lady gets high.
Hi, I'm Kathy. I'm from England originally, Manchester. In England, you'd have just the fields, like you'd be in the fields, it wouldn't be a parking lot, everyone would just be camping where they are, it's more mellow. I mean, the Deadheads is like the traveler scene, isn't it? It's the same kind of way of life, not having a base, just floating around. But the travelers in England, there's like different groups. There's like the Brew Crew lot, which do have a lot of bad press and have created a lot of problems in England. Then you have the very green people, the pagans. It's accepting who you are and loving yourself, who you are. You love the earth, you respect the earth, you love the stars, you love the sky, the moon. You know, you are in tune with nature. It's, you know, it's a beautiful, peaceful religion, if you want to call it a religion.
As you see here, we have Shakedown Street, which is the most, not really a name of the street, but this here is like the busiest place where you could get. Let's see, where you can get mostly everything that Deadhead wants here. Besides privacy and stuff, which is over there where they just want to park and sleep. But over here is where you can get stickers, tie-dyed shirts, tie-dyed clothing, tie-dyed things. Shirts, as you see, I'm wearing one right here. And you can get friendship bracelets, and you can sell your things for money, and you can go out there and trade all your things. And mostly it's just the funnest place. This is one place where I'm talking about where you can get food. Check that out. Yes, I got friends on tour. Yeah, if you want to, well, I'm gonna show you a couple of them. Yeah, this here is Fast Eddie, it's Rainbow Warrior, or whatever.
Rainbow Warrior, Deadhead, an American hippie. Been out there and following the Grateful Dead 16 beautiful rainbow years. Living a life as an American hippie, just trying to make it in America. Living it fullest. And hanging in there and getting ready for Woodstock this year. And we're going to tear it up there this year.
We do the job right because we do it twice.
Right on. That's all you get, guys.
We do the job right because we do it twice.
All
right,
brother. Give him a lap, bro.
What?
One lap. Give him a wavy lap.
Oh God, the first Dead show I saw was probably 1967, back at, might have been the Boston Tea Party, back in Massachusetts. I was still in high school. It was a blast, it was a real blast. Our commune, the Earth People's Park commune, we bought land in the late 60s and early 70s and let whoever wanted to live on it, live on it. We bought a mile on the Canadian border in Norton, Vermont. That is still there. We have 90 acres in the California Redwoods that's there for anybody to live on. It's deeded to everybody on Earth. We have, you know, wild sexual orgies. I mean, it was nothing. It was being free. It was the freest I think I'd ever been. I mean, there was no hang-ups or anything, but you could be walking by a room and there'd be 10 or 15 people in there having fun. And I remember, we went to the Clap Clinic in Berkeley once because someone from the East Coast had been visiting, and turned out they had the clap, and there was about 18 of us the next day just taking precautions.
I don't agree with, you know, free sex and that kind of free love as in the 60s.
I think that free love is a much bigger concept than just sex. I think it would include sharing with your brothers and your sisters, concern about the world.
I think a lot of people confuse the 60s with the Grateful Dead kind of cult, because I think it's so much different. I think a lot of us are for the 90s and for what's happening now instead of trying to relive the 60s.
I remember once We did this free concert with the Grateful Dead in October of 75 in Golden Gate Park. It was the last one that they did before Bill Graham died. It's early morning. We were doing the security and the setup and everything, and we hear this sound way off in the background. It sort of sounds like thunder, and it keeps getting louder the closer it gets. And we're wondering, you know, just what the hell is this noise that's coming? And as it gets really close, we can tell it sounds like a pack of motorcycles, Harleys. Well, it's the Hell's Angels. There's about 200 of them. They pull up to the backstage entrance. The first two that are riding up front leap off their bikes, just like cowboys coming off a trail drive. They casually walk up to the fence, pull out their wire cutters, cut the fence, roll it back. Now, real nonchalantly, all the bikes come in. They roll back the fence, hook it up.
Seems to be lost. As the children, they have no cause to follow, and very few heroes. We try to teach young people not to abuse their body or their soul, and try to do good and get along with people. And as you can see, we seem to do it pretty well.
This has always been there for me, and my family has always been there, but spread out physically. And here, it's like a group of people that are always in one place. This is my last tour forever. This is it. This is the last tour, and after that, I'm gonna get a real job and try and assimilate into the real world.
I think that I don't know. I think there's a lot of young kids homeless that no one really wants, and they just end up here. They're here for the drugs, you know, some sense of family, but. If this is the only family they can find, you know, I think that's pretty bad, because I don't know, I think most of the kids who end up here like that end up, you know, they're 16, they're smoking crack, they're smoking coke, or they're booting, you know, heroin. You know, it's not, I don't think it's as pretty as what it appears to be.
I mean, you know, come the middle of the night, there's fights, there's blood. I mean, in most of the arenas, there's a there's an effort to get most of these people out of there by then.
When I first did this, you know, I could make money and I could see the shows every night. I had a nice time. I got to see the country for free. You know, the only reason I come now is it's a job. You know, I have a job when I'm not here. But I make $5 an hour at a bakery. So I work all week and I make, what, $100, $150? You know, on a good night I can make that in an hour.
The last 4 or 5 years, it's definitely deteriorated. I think you can definitely trace it to around 88, 89. And the Grateful Dead's popularity took off then. I mean, before then, there wasn't the little teeny bopper scene, which there is now. And that has definitely increased over the last 5 or 6 years, which has helped to increase vending, which has helped to increase drugs. Minimum drug sentencing has become huge. I mean, it used to be 5 years ago, people would walk around and say LSD. I mean, wide open. It was mushrooms, LSD. Every third person was saying LSD, LSD, ecstasy, ecstasy. Now you hear little whispers because people are afraid that they're going to get arrested with a half a page of LSD and go to jail for 10 years. Some of it has to do with the Grateful Dead. I mean, they've pretty much been apathetic and apolitical for all these years, and that helps to cause a problem.
And this is my last tour because I can't stand what it's like out here. You know, these people say, oh, we're peaceful, we're respectful, we love, but you know, they don't do any of those things. They're disrespectful, they don't understand common courtesy, they don't have respect for other people, they have no boundaries, you know, with other people. I think they use that as a cover to be selfish, you know. I don't know. You know, I'm sad because I like the music. I hate coming. I hate at 3 o'clock, you know. I said come down here with your camera at 3. see the violence, see the drugs. Man, I sleep with a weapon here. I'm scared.
Gave away everything. Sold my car, $75. Came here with my girlfriend, traveling around, seeing the world, seeing life, living. Free from just jobs, a lot of worries. Just traveling around. This is my first show. Not my first time with drugs. It's great.
A few days ago, my friend, he was in the Cal Expo shows, and he saw a friend of his, this girl, and she said that on her way to Cal Expo show, she was driving like through the trees or something, like redwoods or something, and she saw an angel walking in the trees. And so she pulled over to see what the angel was doing, and the angel told her that on June 17th, 1994, that the first trumpet will blow of the seven angels in Revelations. And the girl who was driving, she was just like really freaked out by what she had just seen. And so she just kept driving, and a cop pulled her over. And she told the cop her story, and the cop said that eight other people had told her the same thing.
Love. Ooh, the universal language besides music, man. Raging and rising. Love, 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 yeah. Let's see.
I don't think I've fallen in love with anyone yet. But there's a lot of fucking cute boys out there, dude. The highest concentration of cute boys is on the dead lot, and it's really cool. In the world, dude. And so fucking fuck love, dude.
In the world.
So
besides Janae, come on.
I suppose love's like a good ideal, but there's just so many cuties, dude. Fuck it.
My parents were divorced, and so I just stayed with my mother. She was kind of young, so I just went where she went, you know. I was about 8 years old, my first show. Also, that same year, I went to my first rainbow gathering.
I live in a very faithful way, and I know that things are going to happen to Babylon, you know? Things are going to happen to make
this
peace happen.
To make the society realize it. It's not working now. People are not. We're becoming overpopulated, and everyone's just. It's money, money, money. You know.
In my heart, I know that I am going to live, and I know that no matter what earth changes happen, Jah will always guide me to the safe place where those things have to happen. And that's what Grateful Dead teaches me. You know, all these people here—they're all here for the same reasons. They're all here. For that vibe, you know, the love vibe.
That you cannot find anywhere else.
You can't become a part of the concrete jungle, you know?
We drove from Ontario to Chicago, and our one van wasn't working right, so we left it there with our stuff in it and met a guy at a blues festival down there that said he'd drive us to Sacramento. And so we drove with him, and the van broke down like six times. And got it towed like 200 miles. And then we made it there, and we had to leave it there because we couldn't afford to get it fixed. And then we rented a U-Haul. We said we were moving, and we took a U-Haul from there to Seattle. And so now we don't have any wheels or anything. We're just getting rides on the Miracle Bus.
I suppose you could just follow the Grateful Dead and dedicate yourself to, you know, be dedicated, but that's not much of an existence if you don't have some purpose, you know.
And like right now, I'm on ecstasy, and what that shows me is all the different fears I have, and it helps me to just break down all those walls and stop getting stuck in such the movie of things, you know, and to stand up high on top of the mountain and look down and just see the truth within it all, and that we will always have everything we need. If we believe in Mother Earth, she will always protect us. And those who don't believe in her, then they're gonna get caught up in the destruction of it all. But I have faith that
there's going to be peace on Earth, and those people who believe, they're gonna all be here to see it. And those people who don't believe, they're just gonna see the destruction of it.
Just all the people in Babylon,
like
all the people.
Would you like me
to
sing
me a song?
Yeah. Okay. My sister Blue taught me this. The river, she is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea. The river, she is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea. Mother, carry me, your child I'll always be. Father, carry me down to the sea. The river, she is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea.
Tour's hard, man. Don't let anybody tell you it's easy. You can make a couple of shirts and go make $1 million, because it ain't gonna happen. You kids, don't try this at home. That's what I'm telling you. If you don't know what the hell you're doing, stay the fuck home with your parents. Or go fucking get a job, get real.
There's some fucked up people that go around and just come around dead shows to rip stuff off. There's quite a few of them, as a matter of fact. See, I was asleep. I had like my whole lot for me ganked from me and Eugene.
We had a typical VW van drive that broke down on us. We were trying to bum start at a rest stop, and our friend's Pitbull got out of his car and we left him there by accident.
Everybody jumped back into the car and we took off and forgot Magoo at the rest area. It's pretty devastating for us because it was part of our family. And,
I love my dog. He's gone. I miss him. I miss him a lot. I want him back. If somebody will help me get him back, I'd do anything for that person. He's a pit bull, but he doesn't fight other dogs. He's really such a friendly dog, where a poodle could probably beat him up.
So many people, no place to lay their heads, standing in soup lines to get their daily bread, and wondering, where's their piece of the dream?
Take what you need, leave what you have.
The sadness in their eyes reflects the pain. They sleep in cardboard boxes to keep.
You just never know. It's a gamble. You go on tour, you go from show to show. If you're a vendor, it's a gamble. And if you're a vendor, you should be nice enough to pick your shit up behind you and not be a fucking mess like all you asshole food vendors and beer vendors who don't give a fuck about nobody. And you sell your shit, and you fucking leave, and you go to the next show, and you sell your shit, and what do you leave behind? You don't put nothing into the scene. All you fucking do is leave your big fucking mess.
Basically, we manufacture and sell tie-dyes to dead customers. About 75,000 a year, roughly, doing that.
Vendors are blamed for the decline and, you know, like the decadence of what's happened out here.
I mean, there's definitely times when other people see us that way. Definitely, are like, oh, those damn vendors, or and we in turn say the same thing about other people. Oh, those damn whatever. And so it's just like, it is a microcosm of the world, because everybody is. It's those damn whoever, and it's always that those damn whoever's.
So a lot of people who don't vend see us as like, you know, the real problem in the parking lot. Why the police are so harsh? Why Grateful Dead comes down on the people in the parking lot so hard? You know, and I guess, you know, that kind of fits a little.
You're fucking the whole scene up. And that's it. And you nitrous guys should be fucking in the same category with them. You shouldn't be coming anymore either. You don't care about anything, and the dead are really sick of it. I know they are.
Now out in Vegas, you have to worry about just getting to a campground before you get pulled over and checkpoints.
There's so few places in the world that you can go and truly feel like yourself, truly be yourself, and that's okay because the people around you are truly being themselves. And the Dead shows to me are one of the last vestiges of Free Zone. Human beings have a basic fundamental need to be with masses of other human beings at certain times. I don't know why that is, but it's clear people will go to sports arenas in large mass groups, people will go to church in mass groups, people will go to concerts, different bands. Now the ego has a chance to drop away and cleanse itself.
I grew up in like a real, I guess, ghetto type area, you could say. And I got into like stealing and drugs, you know, at like 11 years old. The culture that people are brought up in, you know, the background, and it doesn't make that person necessarily bad. It's just that sometimes people just don't know better, you know? I just realized that if you respect the Mother Earth as your own body, then it respects you, and it's like a whole divine plan, you know, this great mystery of just pure love, you know? And if you can see things that way, then everything will always be the way you want it. Everything will always flow the way you want it. You don't need money, you don't need, you know, material things. All you need is nature, and Jah will always provide, you know? You know, it's just flowing. That's just what I'm into now.
Stanley Mouse said, I thought that the guy on the cover was really cool. And he said, well, that's you. And I went, oh, it's hard to tell without the skin. And he said, it's Omega Woman. That's what he calls this. Here they're burning their first gold record, or trying to. They couldn't burn it, so they ended up shooting it later. But after that was after they took it apart and played it and everything like that. And then Bill Graham did the introduction for me. And I said, when I first asked him, he goes, why do you want me to do this? Because you're famous and it'll help me sell books. Why else? I said, and besides that, you'll complain if I don't ask you.
In my fantasy, I see myself walking in a room, a long, beautiful, like ballroom, and I have a very low-cut red dress on, like the red dress he sings about in Same Thing, the song by Willie Nelson. He sang that last night. Felt so good. And I see myself, and he sees me, and he goes, me, and he swoops me up and dances me away in the ballroom.
I met them August the 2nd, 1968, and they came to play at our ballroom in San Diego, the Hippodrome. Christina was like about 5 and Creek was 3, and Mickey's the only dad that they've ever really had. He said, I said, what was it about me that you liked? Anyway, he said, I thought you were kind of fat, but I liked how you handled your clipboard. And I said, oh, it's so romantic, dear. Years later, I asked him. Yeah, he said, he was asking me, well, did we have sex on our first date? I go, sex? I go, geez, we dated for about a year before we had sex. What are you talking about? Mickey and Phil went to Bill's house late at night, and I went with them. And they marched around in his driveway with these tambourines and these placards going, hurry, Bobo, Uncle Bobo, hurry, hurry. And Bill comes up and goes, what do you want now? You blessed me. It's like 11:30 at night. So they said, we want to go to Egypt, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, this is in 1977. And he's saying, it's very bad over there. We can't go to Egypt. And here's Bill a few days after we've been in Egypt. Because we said, just come and be our friend and be our guest. Okay, Bill. Bill's feeling a lot better now. And we had wonderful adventures there. So Big N, Carter, and Sadat were meeting at Camp David. The weekend the Grateful Dead were playing at the Pyramid, and Jahan Sadat was on stage with us, and there was an eclipse of the full moon only visible from the Eastern Hemisphere, and it was the 35th anniversary of Hoffman's discovery of LSD. It was quite auspicious, as it turned out. It was quite lovely. You know, there's no way we could have planned all that to happen, especially the Camp David talks. It was wonderful.
I got a hole in my finger. Stop the pain, will linger like rust on an old tin can. I ain't got nothing.
Actually, I kind of have it down to an economic system. $15 worth of fruit will get me 50 fruit cups at $1 a piece, so $35 profit on a $15 investment.
I'm self-employed. I set my own hours. I bring in $45, $50 in a half an hour's time. I've been learning to get by on like $3 to $5 a day. I'm gonna be 30 in January. This is like the final summer of my youth, I guess. I've wanted to do this for 10 years. It's hard to justify it to myself when I think about, you know, if I'm gonna have children and that kind of thing. It's just, it's not very stable. I've been to 12 shows on this summer tour and I haven't been into a single one.
The first people who come down here, those three names I just called out, will have your choice again of the Stone Temple Pilots tickets, the Grateful Dead tickets, or the Fight tickets.
It would be nice to be able to just cruise around the country following a band.
The crowd's cool, everybody has a good time, they bring a lot of money into the valley, so I have nothing but positive things to say about the Dead.
The women, some of the women are pretty hot looking, you know, especially the way they dress. It's like, man.
There's just a lot of magic here, and there's a lot of bad stuff too. So I want to take a hold of the magic and spread that around. If I was normal, I'd be graduating from high school today on Long Island wearing a cap and gown, but I'm here in Nevada. Like, it's so much better. People who think deadheads are dangerous are silly, because we are so nice.
I went to college for 3.5 years, and then I quit and became a stripper.
I've been homeschooled.
We get curriculum from libraries and even curriculum from yard sales and stuff.
Well, I study on like math and science and I usually read.
I do own a home in Albuquerque, and so at his school, his three main teachers are all deadheads, and they work with us, and they totally envious. We do testing in April so we can pass to the next grade. And we also do IQ aptitude tests. His last one he scored 131 IQ on. So no chromosome damage there.
When our kids were growing up, we said to them, look, obviously you guys are going to want to experiment with drugs because, you know, like father, like son, whatever, it's a family tradition. My son in particular made a big mistake one New Year's Eve where he saw a vial roll off over in the corner that somebody dumped all this stuff on a table in a dressing room. He saw this one little vial roll off in the corner and there was a C scratched on the top of it. He thought that meant cocaine. You know, he's like 13. He's 27 now, he lived through it. But it meant crystal. And him and his buddy lined up two big old whopping railroad ties, you know, full of that and snorted it up, man. It was New Year's Eve. And the band went on for the encore, the first encore. And they came back after 10 minutes and we have two boys that are going, I'm dead, I'm dying.
It's magic. It's magic without the dope. It's totally magic.
I've been going to shows since 1986. And I always used to go and have a good time and party and really party.
To be honest, last year was my first Sober Dead concert right here in Las Vegas. And it was the best time I ever had at a Dead concert.
I got myself sober and then I found out about the Wharf Rats.
I get the same trippy experience that someone who is tripping on acid would get from the Dead, just because I can be there and I can be free, I can be dancing, and I'm around friends.
Doing alcohol, to dropping acid, to smoking coke, snorting coke, shooting coke. I'm a miracle just to be alive.
And you know, the thing about the Grateful Dead is the Dead, the scene, the people, the music, that's what's fun. And a lot of people kind of mix up the drugs as sort of the reason you go and do that.
I was moving, I was singing, I was in awe, I was screaming. I was just happy, happy-go-lucky. Nothing could have shit on my parade today.
I wasn't tired the next day. I woke up, I wasn't hungover, I wasn't burnt out, and I could find my car in the parking lot.
A great deal of deadheads who are 9-to-5ers or professional people, and we save up our money and we fly to shows, we stay in hotels. The Dead is very tribal, so we're all coming from different tribes to meet in one big tribe. We're all tempted to get on a bus and follow the dead around.
It's all consuming for them. I mean, what causes these people to put everything in their lives aside and traipse around after this band?
Well, I'm a professional figure skater. I represented Mexico in the 1988 Olympics. The Olympics was always my dream since I was 7. And that's what I did all my life. And so this is almost the opposite, my other personality.
And I think all deadheads have a fantasy about meeting, you know, someone in the dead, like we'd all like to be a friend with Jerry, or we'd all like to hang around with Mickey and play the drums, or, you know, Bobby just happens to be the more sexual fantasy.
This is a quote from Jerry from my book. It says, music, the interviewer is asking, music obviously exerts a tremendous force on this country. And Garcia says, oh yeah, I guess it does, but that doesn't mean I ought to carry around the responsibility of being the guy that dispenses our music. You know what I mean? It's like being the president. I don't want it. I don't want the fucking job. I mean, I liked it when you could just be a musician. It's like being an artist and a craftsman or something. Nobody mobs a cat that makes nice leather work or a guy that does woodwork.
Well, my first show I went to in 80 and thought it was like, I've never experienced anything like that. It was, I met some of the nicest people who showed me some crafts. I was young. I think I was like 14 or something like that. And I was like, I experienced LSD at those shows for the first time. And all I wanted to do was learn something. It was really weird. It was like, when I did it, I wanted to know everything about everything. It was like a wonder drug to me. I find out it's not anymore, but it was just, it was cool. And I was going to school, stopped going to school, went to the shows. You know, I finally ended up finishing up school, going to an alternative high school, but finish school, don't go on tour and quit school. Don't listen to me. I mean, it was just a thing that happened. It happens to people.
I wake up every morning and face the brand new day. Keep searching for my miracle and hope I find my way.
Favorite Dead song? St. Stephen.
Eyes of the World is my favorite.
I like Shake Down Street.
Terrapin Station.
I can't think of the name of the song.
Good Lovin'.
I like the fun songs.
Bertha.
Oh, I like music.
Blues for Allers, the one at the end that just floats you off.
Definitely Fireman.
Probably They Love Each Other.
And my old-time Great. Favorite's Cumberland.
Uncle John's Band.
Music Never Stopped.
Probably Truck.
Sugar Magnolia.
Trekking, man.
Cassidy, which is what I named my dog.
Friend of the Devil.
I want to hear St. Stephen.
Wake Up Morning Dew.
Dexter.
When I can walk on water.
Trekking.
Dark Star.
The next one.
I want my MTV. That's my favorite.
That's not a Grateful Dead song.
No, I don't care. What's your
name? Me and my uncle. Okay, go. Gotta like trucking.
I am a Cassidy lover.
Buddy, what's your favorite Grateful Dead song? Has to be Bread.
Well, I think it's the biggest thing to hit Vermont since the Revolutionary War.
16.
I'm 12.
You feel great.
The people are great. It's fun.
Nice. This is the first time that something like this has ever been around here.
Cool. I like it. Neat.
They've been very friendly people, wishing us luck and telling us to have a good time. They've been great so far.
A little over 400, about 408 shows that I've seen.
It seems to me like most of what I've heard about this scene is not true, because we've gotten a lot of nasty comments, nasty looks because of the way we look. It's like people will be open-minded towards you if you look like you belong at a Grateful Dead show, but if you don't look like you belong, then you get treated just like people treat you anywhere else where you don't belong. Apparently it's, you know, how you look, you know, if you have dreadlocks are the right length, if your skirt's baggy enough. This is the last place I expected to be shunned because of the way I look.
She painted me.
I painted her over here and then over here. Everyone expects different things from
Michelle. Lots of new people.
Yeah.
Like her.
Right on. I met her last weekend. She's such like a beautiful person.
grocery stores and liquor stores can't keep up with inventory, or, you know, we become a very big traveling gypsy band.
This is the busiest day we've had, yes, for a long, long time. Well, basically, we got to sell, like, keep all these people happy, so we're making grinders and beverages and trying to get gas and anything they might need, we're trying to get provided for them.
I've never heard of them. I'll be honest with you. I never heard of them. No, we're having a wonderful time today. Very nice people, very nice. No problems. And the money is coming in.
Dead is once Jerry stops touring, are going to come to the Rainbow Family. Rainbow Family is the only stronghold of people who really care. It was based on an old Hopi Indian prophecy that says, when the earth is dying and the animals are weeping, there should come a tribe of people to save the earth. They should be called the Warriors of the Rainbow. So all the deadheads are going to come to the Rainbow Family, because that's where we gather. That's where we pray for peace and love, freedom, and everything that's way cool. Drugs aren't a part of it anymore, man. You gotta stay high, because drugs ain't no good, other than peyote.
The Grateful Dead have allowed people to tape their concerts and collect and trade them. I have over 2,000 cassette tapes and well over 500 DAT, or digital tapes. The Grateful Dead, in any given year, typically play 130, 140 different songs. I think they've written about 300 or so. They've played 437 different ones that we know of throughout the years. There's a lot of variety there. They've never played the same combination of songs twice for a full set list that we know of. And I think they enjoy being unpredictable. My favorite years tend to be 1970. I like 73 a lot. It gets very jazzy in there. 77 was a good rock and hard rock and roll year. 1986 was a bad year for Deadheads because of Jerry's collapse. 1990 was a fantastic year. It was a very creative year for them.
My name is Uncle Sam, and spreading happiness is my plan.
You know, well over a million people buy Grateful Dead tickets every year. Last year, they sold more tickets than any other band.
I'm here to meet Jerry, hopefully. If he sees me, maybe he'll like bring me up on stage and get to dance with the band, although I doubt that.
This is free miracle ticket. Here you go. Have a good show.
Thank you.
Yeah! If you don't have tickets, come anyway and party with Uncle Sam.
If anyone needs a ride for RFK, you know, I got tickets. I can help pay for gas. You know, I got cash. I can help anyone out that needs it.
No problems. We had one arrest out of 65,000 people. The population in this county is only 30,000, so you're double the population in this county. I expected totally something different, that we were going to have 200 arrests and people are going to be out of control.
In the Dead parking lot is the sense of brotherhood. Okay, there's a sense of people coming together, sharing, caring for one another, and it's kind of unique in that sense. Most people today come from broken families, you know, so there's been a degeneration of the family unit. They've seen their parents' lives. There's no connection there. They've seen the hollowness of it, and they rebel against it. They look for any other alternative.
That's why we're here. We're here looking for the one or two in this whole crowd that would forsake everything they're doing on the face of the earth to help bring the kingdom of God on the earth.
Last tour, three people came. One of them's here right now.
People have come and bumped into us, and they didn't know they were looking for us. But when they met us, they said, I can't believe it. This is what I was born to do. And now there's probably 80, 100 people who we've met in these crowds who just leave everything behind.
We're in East Boston and we're home and we feel great.
The thing I miss the most about tour is like I have so many friends at the shows and meet so many new friends, and I'm always meeting new people that, like, when I come back here to the city in Boston, a lot of the people I don't really care to meet. Last time I talked to you guys, I was saying I would never go. That was because my dog and everything and all that. And meeting a lot of assholes out on the West Coast didn't help at all either. But I don't know. I'll probably still go to shows, but I won't go out to California. I say I won't, but who the hell knows? I mean,
he's said that before.
Yes, I've said it before. I always go back
over and over again. You forget from one summer to the next how it is.
My name is Monica Pratt. I work for Families Against Mandatory Minimums. FAM is comprised of inmates and their family members who are serving mandatory minimum sentences in state and federal prisons. If this was LSD, you'd be in prison for 5 years. No breaks, no parole, no kidding, and it's no joke. And especially if you're a first-time offender, you think that I'm not going to get in that much trouble. The sad fact of the matter is that until Congress repeals mandatory minimums, until we as deadheads and as people who care about freedom can convince Congress to change these laws, this amount of LSD, a very small amount of marijuana, can get you into prison for a very long time.
So many people out here, I guess they think that they're not going to get busted if they're selling acid or selling something else, and it's just kind of naive, and people just, they get busted and they turn other people in, and it's just big mess, and now there's something like 2,000 deadheads in prison, and it sucks.
I'm Peter Gorman. I'm the executive editor for High Times magazine. The mandatory minimum set up in 86 established that for every gram of LSD in your possession, for the first gram, you would serve 5 years in a federal penitentiary, no exceptions to the rule, unless you snitched or gave the federal government an enormous amount of money. One of the groups that seems to have been targeted, or appears to have been targeted, probably because they're very easy access, are deadheads. Deadheads deal with LSD. The dead shows have brought out LSD heads for the last 25 years and will for the next 25 years. Two or three of the policemen who are undercover are alleged to have been working the dead shows for more than 10 years now. And they're kind of elder statesman hippies.
This is FAM's memorial wall, and they're pictures of inmates and their family members that we've been working with over the years since FAM got started. For instance, most of these people are family members. Some of them are younger, some of them are older. None of them are the typical people that you would think would be in prison for drugs. This man's serving a 10-year sentence. This woman's serving a 5-year sentence. This man is serving a 10-year sentence for marijuana. This is Christian Martinson. He's serving a 10-year sentence for LSD. This is Jeff Stewart. He's serving a 5-year mandatory minimum.
If LSD was packaged on paper, it was weighed with the paper. So kids who are serving time for a gram of LSD, 95-97% of the time that they're serving is being served for paper. On a sugar cube, one hit of LSD might come up to 2 or 3 grams, which would get you between 5 and 10 years. One hit of LSD on a strawberry could get you 20 years in a federal prison. There is no parole board. You cannot be let out for good behavior.
Don't you know I gotta get stoned every day?
One of the things about the deadheads, which seems tragic to most of us in the anti-drug war business, is that the average age of the kids being busted and serving federal mandatory time is probably between 17 and 22 or 23 years old. If you do LSD at a dead show, you don't buy it at a dead show. You don't sell it at a dead show. Find another way. I mean, even though you mean well, there are too many undercover police working. The penalties are much too severe. You're not doing it to make money. You're doing it to try to be nice. That's the only reason anybody ever sells LSD. You mean well for the other person. They need a spiritual aid. You happen to have one. If they had a cough, you'd give them a cough drop.
Don't deal on tour. It's not necessary. Use it as a sacred ritual. If you must trip, keep it personal, make it personal, make it your own ritual. Don't put yourself in the position of having to go to jail for 30 years for it.
They told us that in this part of the country,
A law has been passed that if you have dead stickers in your windows, that's probable cause. You don't have any rights. Actually, a federal marshal came on with this smoke screen looking for the acid murderer. This guy who takes LSD and kills people, which I've never heard of any such thing in all my life. It's government propaganda, if you ask me.
There's someone filming us from across the way, and the DEA and the federal marshal are in the car in the parking lot waiting to talk to us.
And we go to the bus, there's a warrant on the seat.
They took his driver's license, his birth certificate, the title to the bus, my passport, my business license.
This is great for JD. Why should we shelter him? Why should we shelter him against what's really going on? There's some bad things going on. I love this country with all my heart, but the government is corrupt and they can't say they're not.
When I started going to shows, I was still inside of my mother.
Sometimes I had to go sit down. He was so active when he heard the music.
I've seen over 100 shows.
Having a kid is having a kid, no matter where you have a kid.
I like your music, and I like to hang out in the parking lot.
He is in the Young Scholars Program. He's top 1% in the country.
My favorite thing about the concert is dancing.
Traveling, of course, it's an educating experience in itself.
I consider myself as a deadhead.
Sean is a little wary of saying to other kids that aren't involved in the scene that he likes the Grateful Dead.
I don't really talk to my friends about it a lot.
They're supposed to enjoy playing Super Nintendo or Sega Genesis or something of that nature.
Once I met some of the band, I think, from a backstage pass, and I think I shook hands with Jerry Garcia.
Well, we're here today, Benton, the Dead Show. Okay, this is actually where our business began 2 years ago. I met him, he made shirts, I made jewelry, we quit our jobs and came out on tour. Now we have some stores in the Philadelphia area. We band other music festivals, Lollapalooza, The Horde, Reggae Soul Splash. Today's our day off.
So
We're out playing.
It's just all about being kind to each other and being friends with everybody, no matter what they look like.
My mom has asked me a lot over the years if I've ever thought that I've wasted my life, and I really can't say so because I've had so much fun, I've seen so many things. Okay, maybe I'm not a millionaire, but you know, life's more than just money. You know, riches aren't necessarily how much money you've got. Some of the most unhappy people I've ever met have been people with a lot of money.
I've had five of these vans just like this, and they always break down. And you know what I do? I get out and I start hitchhiking. This guy took me home from the Phoenix shows, and he drove me home. His name's Pokey.
I know Pokey.
From Syracuse?
Yeah, he had a white bus.
Yeah, he had a white bus. He drove me all the way home from Alabama to Alabama from the Phoenix shows.
That's right. He missed the Chicago shows because of it.
Because of that, yeah, but I still made it. But he didn't even want to go to Chicago because it was too cold.
He went to Atlanta or something.
No, he went to the gathering in Louisiana. But anyway, Pokey drove me home to Alabama from Phoenix. I decided to go get my bus in Oregon, so I split and I went to Oregon to get my bus. But these girls, I picked them up on the westbound side, but they were going east because this trucker was messing with them. So they went to the westbound side, so I picked them up hitchhiking, went all the way to Oregon with them, right? And then, this was a friend of mine's car, and I lost the car. It was an 88 Prelude. I said, wind, autumn, here. Take this car, go get gas money and everything. Then my bus broke down, so I had to call my friend and go, I lost your car, man, an 88 Prelude. I lost your car, bro, I'm really sorry. He's like, don't worry, it'll come back to me. When the bus broke down in Needles, I had to hitchhike all the way back east because the bus broke down in Needles. I got back east and guess what? The girls drove the car back to Alabama for me. They were so nice, they were so cool. And they're here on the lot, Pokey is with the girls now.
Is that the car he was driving?
Imagine that. I saw Pokey. I run up to Pokey. I'm like, Pokey, hey, what's going on, man? And I look in the back seat, and it's the girls. I'm like, oh my God, it's a small world. It just keeps going in circles.
No one likes to speculate on when the Grateful Dead will stop touring. I think the Grateful Dead have carved a niche in history, especially musical history, that won't be erased without with their not touring. So there really is a whole culture that's grown out of the Grateful Dead phenomenon and continues to thrive and will continue to thrive because our children are picking up all of this stuff from us, and hopefully their children will pick it up from them, and we'll have a very peaceful, environmentally conscious future. And within the Deadhead community, that exists, and I hope that the Deadhead philosophies and the Deadhead values continue long after the Grateful Dead stop touring.
Since we've seen you guys in Eugene, we went through the drive-thru chapel and got married on the school bus. Went and the Dead show was our reception. So now we're on our perpetual honeymoon. The perpetual honeymoon.
The river, she is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea. The river, she is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea. Mother, carry me, your child I'll always be. Father, carry me down to the sea. She is flowing, flowing and growing. The river, she is flowing down to the sea.
Hi, my name's Jari. You'll see some footage of my dog here, Magoo. And if you could do me a favor, if you've seen my dog or you know someone who has him, I'm not going to press charges or nothing like that. Just help me get my dog back. My phone number is 567-4959. Edit that out. And remember, peace, love, and keep the fucking scene clean.
Bye.
What is going to be the theme of your meeting?
It's going to be a graduation ceremony and a commencement exercise, essentially for the heads. And other people that would like to know what the heads are doing.
Are you going to tell what's bad about LSD?
Not necessarily.
Will LSD be in evidence at the graduation ceremony, Ken?
Why don't you guys come?
Yeah.
The acid test was breaking out into an area in which it had no specific goals. It was just discovering what there was out there if you just continued to move away from the norm. And when we got to the end of it, we really had a sense of what the acid test meant to a lot of people. It was a test, and there were people that passed and there were people that didn't pass. When we did the show up in Portland, to give you an example of somebody who passed, some businessman just walking around the street came in. We charged a buck. For a buck, you got to see us make all our noise and the dead make all their noise and anything else that happened. This guy was in a suit and had an umbrella, and he got the customary cup of stuff. And about midnight, you could see him really get ripped. Somebody, you know, had probably never been anything but drunk on beer. But he looked around and saw all these strange people. Then he looked down and the spotlight was showing down on him. He saw a shadow down there. He's going to stand up straight, put that umbrella over his shoulder, and he says, "The king walks." And he begins, he says, "The king turns around." Now the king will dance. They weren't just playing what was on the music sheets. They were playing what was in the air. When the dead are at their best, the vibrations that are stirred up by the audience is the music that they play. And consequently, when we'd go to L.A., you'd get one kind of thing. When you'd go to Portland, Oregon, you get a completely other kind of music. And that means that the band has to be supple enough to really read the notes written on the wall, and that they're changing all the time. I don't know of any other rock band that could have done it. Usually, when it sort of started when we went to see the Beatles. They went up to see the Beatles with us in the bus, and I saw Power like I'd never seen it, I'd never imagined it before. When one of the Beatles, when George would turn his head like this, you'd hear this screaming wave follow his head like this. And what the Beatles were saying was, "Come closer, come closer, love me do." And the people were pressing closer and closer, but they didn't know how to sing that moment. And the moment needed to say, "Don't come closer, stay back, stay back, stay back." They're looking for magic. When I did my writing class, I started the writing class by showing the people this. And the reason I like to do that is because there's a moment when you see something like that, there's a crack in your mind, and you know it's a trick, but you can't figure it out. And that crack lets in all the light. It opens up all the possibilities. When that little split-second thing happens, when the dead are playing, and everybody in the audience goes, "Wow, did you see that?" That's the moment, and kids will watch 5 hours of mediocre music to have that one click happen, because that puts them in touch with the invisible. There was a time when we avoided fame because fame was almost the kiss of death. Fame meant Tom Jones and John Denver. But cream rises and people can recognize it. And as the dead, the longer they've played, they haven't needed anybody to hype them. In fact, if anything, they've gone the reverse to let people think, oh, this is nothing happening here, because everybody knew from the very beginning that this was right, and it was going to continue just the same way that those flowers bloom, that it's genetically purposeful. It knows what it's doing, and it will grow to its proper height, and it will bear a flower. And all we have to do is keep people from tramping around in the flower garden. When you hear ripple, you know it's dealing with something beyond the veil. It doesn't say so, but the thing where there is no pebble tossed in the ripples in the water, everybody gets this chill up and by that. It's the same thing as when you read Shakespeare or Sappho or the Bible, that the poetry is there. These guys have known it a long time, and they have just been the custodians of it. And it's a great honor and a lot of fun to be ringside with stuff like this. It really is. You will, I think that in 20 years, whoever is still alive will still be working at what they're doing. There's no place else to go. It's like me. You know, I buried my kid right out there on the place. I can't get off this land. You know, it would take tanks to move me off this land. The dead aren't going to get up off that. They're going to defend it to the end of their life. They're warriors.